And welcome, Hoosier fans, to another victorious episode of the Assembly Call, as today your Indiana Hoosiers took care of business at home in Simon Scott Assembly Hall, dispatching the Rutgers Scarlet Knights 89-73, moving the Hoosier season record to 17-14, 8-12 in conference play, and certainly making NCAA tournament conversations much more reasonable now after this four-game winning streak. We, of course, will talk about that as we go through the show. I am your host, Jerod Morris. I'm here with Ryan Phillips and Andy Bottoms. We're going to break it all down for you on this edition of the Assembly Call IU Postgame Show. And let's start the show the way we start every show, and that is with our Hoosier Proud banner moment. And, of course, the banner moment has to touch on Juwan Morgan. It was Juwan Morgan Day today at Simon Scott Assembly Hall, the final time that he will take McCracken Court. And boy, did he save one of his best performances for last. And there are a lot of moments that you could pick, but I'm going to go in the second half at the 12:28 mark. Romeo Langford drove toward the baseline, threw a pass kind of behind his head, kind of wrapped it around his head to Juwan Morgan, who was waiting on the right wing for a wide open three-pointer. He drained it. It was his 10th consecutive make to begin the game. It put IU up 20, which was basically the lead that they would nurse for the rest of the game. And really, it was the dagger because, you know, Rutgers came out at the start of the second half. They actually cut it to 9 at one point, and Juwan had to leave after picking up his third foul. But he came back in right after the under 16-minute timeout. He scored 9 straight points, I think, for Indiana after that to push the lead from 12 to 20. And, you know, what was interesting about it being a three-pointer, and I guess a little bit ironic making that the banner moment, is, you know, we've talked about Juwan settling for threes early in games and, you know, and missing a lot of them because he's missed a lot of threes in the second half of the season. But he didn't. Today, he was a man on a mission from the tip, was, you know, getting the ball inside, was 6 for 6 early in the first half to really just put Indiana on his back and you know, kind of put his stamp on the game early on and give Indiana the lead. Didn't settle for any of those threes. But this one was a great one. He was wide open, took it in the rhythm of the offense, drained it. And again, just a fantastic game, you know, and you'll remember back to the beginning of the season, Big Ten Media Day, he guaranteed that Indiana was going to go to the NCAA tournament this season. And he has certainly done everything in his power to make it happen. We'll talk as we go forward on this show about what still needs to happen for Indiana to make that a reality. But today, Juwan Morgan, his final time at home was absolutely fantastic in a game that Indiana absolutely had to have. They did, and they followed their seniors' lead to do it. All right, today's Hoosier Proud banner moment brought to you, as always, by our friends at Hoosier Proud and Home Field. At homefieldapparel.com, you will find the comfiest and most unique licensed IU apparel available anywhere. At hoosierproud.com, you'll find great state of Indiana-themed apparel while sending 10% of your purchase to causes around Indiana, like the Hoosier Veterans Assistance Foundation. Both brands were started by an IU grad, and all Hoosier Proud and Home Field apparel is designed and printed out of Indianapolis. And with the Big Ten and NCAA tournament looming, be sure to check out Homefield's Indiana All the Way t-shirt, featuring an IU basketball design made popular during the school's championship runs. And, of course, you should check out the Bison hoodie, which both Ryan and Andy are wearing as we record this show. That was not planned. I would have worn mine, but I've got this new kind of lucky outfit that I've been wearing that I started wearing 4 games ago. I'm not changing it. I'm not saying that it's making a difference. All I'm saying is I don't know, so I'm not going to tempt fate while we're actually winning games again. But you should definitely check out the Bison hoodie. Check out everything they have at homefieldapparel.com and hoosierproud.com. And, of course, don't forget to use the promo code ASSEMBLY at checkout for 15% off your order on either site. That's promo code ASSEMBLY at hoosierproud.com and homefieldapparel.com. All right, well, it is time to move the ball, find the open man, and get some opening thoughts from the rest of our team. And we will start with Andy Bottoms. Andy, your Bottoms line on a successful afternoon for Indiana.
Well, one of the plays that stood out to me was kind of a vintage McRoberts play that led to what will likely be Juwan's last basket. I say that because we don't want to end up having to play other games there in the NIT, but hopefully Juwan's last basket in Assembly Hall, which was a thunderous dunk off of just kind of a hustle play, like smart tip by McRoberts to Juwan, who took it in and, you know, got to 25 points on today. And it was definitely, the day was all about him. He came out and basically just made it clear from the, you know, from the opening. I mean, he had 12 points and five rebounds, I think, by the even before the under eight timeout, and really set the tone for these guys and played really well. And, you know, when you look at it, there are some things potentially not to love defensively. The fouls were certainly a part of that. But if you look at the offensive numbers, KenPom updated, and in the last two games, IU has had its first and its third best offensive efficiency performances in the last two games. So I don't know what that means with this team. I'm hesitant to make any sweeping conclusions of corners being turned or things like that, but it's a good sign that the offense was really fluid today against a team that really can be pretty rugged defensively, and one that has given IU trouble defensively in the past. You know, Rutgers, even after today, is ranked 45th nationally in adjusted defensive efficiency. So they haven't fared as well in Big Ten play, so that's a factor. But for a team that, you know, plays with a great deal of physicality, I thought IU responded to that for the most part, especially early, and you know, just kept throwing big bodies at them as best they could. But a really solid performance, another good one from IU, and now they've got it off till Thursday. They wait to see who they'll play in the Big Ten tournament. Sounds like, based on my math, it'll be Minnesota or Ohio State. And either way, it'll be at, I think, 12:30 Eastern on Thursday afternoon.
All right, over to Ryan for his opening rant after today's game.
Just got to give hats off to Juwan Morgan. That was a heck of a performance. I think everybody kind of sensed that he was going to get it going, and they kept feeding him. But I don't want to leave out Romeo Langford and Devonte Green, who both had really nice days too. Romeo found his way to get to the line, which he hadn't done consistently this season, just by driving and just get into the teeth of the defense and get fouled. You don't have to make the shot. And 8 of 10 from the free throw line got him to 20 points. So a really nice job from him. He played 35 minutes. That shocked me. Because there were sections of the game where he didn't need to do anything because Juwan was dominating. Juwan had 25 points in 22 minutes. I mean, you know, so it just it was just interesting to look up at the end of the game and see that Romeo played 35 when there were times where he didn't even need to be involved offensively. Played great defensively, of course. I want to harken back to Juwan, though, and the kind of kid he is. When you listen to his senior speech, he's really understated, and he's, you know, joking around and having fun with it. But, you know, all those senior speeches were pretty short, especially considering there were five guys and we were done in like a half hour. A lot of these guys are understated. They're, you know, more quiet guys and lead by example and not, you know, with the words. But I will say about Juwan, I remember my first memory of him is going to be when he was interviewed when IU was having some on court or on campus problems with the team. And they asked him, you know, does that give you, are you hesitant about coming to IU? And he said, no, it makes me want to get there faster and help change the culture. And, you know, he's been part of that. I mean, he's the quintessential 4-year college basketball player. And I remember when we were doing our recruiting evaluation of him and what kind of player he was going to be, we all kind of came to the conclusion he's going to be a 3-4 year player who's going to be an all Big Ten caliber guy when he's done, because that's his growth trajectory. And we wound up being right. And that's what he is. And when you look at a guy like Race Thompson or Rob Finnessy or you know, just some of these other guys, you look at that growth trajectory and that's what you're projecting for them. And so you see the success that a guy like Juwan has had. And then you look at these other guys who are sort of in the chamber and ready to go to do that same thing. That's what they should be aiming for. And not everyone's going to be a one and done. Not everyone's going to be OG Anunoby and get on campus and, you know, just be such a freak athlete that you're going to get drafted as a sophomore. You can wind up having a really successful basketball career by being a 4-year guy. And I think Juwan Morgan is going to go on to play as long as he wants to. Will it be in the NBA? I think so, but who knows for how long. And he can go and play in Europe, do whatever he wants for as long as he wants. And that's a testament to Juwan, the kind of player he is, the kind of kid he is, and the kind of work he put in to get better. And he was that way the day he stepped on campus and even beforehand. When you hear a kid say, I want to get there and help change a culture, you know what you're getting as a player. And so hats off to Juwan for what's been a great career. You heard him listing off how many of the top 10s he's in all time as an Indiana player. And you get in a top 10 list at Indiana, it means you did something special during your career. I don't care if it's top 10, you know, deflections, to throw out another coach's term, but I don't care what stat it is. If you get it, you get in the top 10 on any list at Indiana, you've had a great career. And so hats off to Juwan. He had a great career and he capped it off with a great performance today.
Absolutely. And it, you know, it's a great point that you bring up about the leadership part of it. He had a great line in the speech where he said that everybody on the team calls him Uncle J-Mo, you know, because he's the one they call when they need something.
He love that he's one of Deron Davis's emergency contacts.
That was such a great line. Such a great line. Now it's, you know, senior day is one of those things, like I have a love-hate feeling about it, you know, because you love just the moments and seeing these guys give speeches, but you hate it because, you know you're not going to see these guys again. And it's special with guys like Juwan, guys like Yogi, guys like Robert Johnson last year when, you know, they've played so much over 4 years and you develop such a relationship with them as a fan. And
that's the rewarding part about being a fan, is seeing a guy like Juwan go from, you know, skinny freshman who helps them win a Big Ten title to the down years and then to being the leader this year. I mean, the two most rewarding, I'd say Juwan is certainly one, but the other most rewarding careers were a guy like Victor Oladipo, who came in as a completely unheralded recruit who was bouncy and fun to watch, but, you know, kind of frustrating, to superstar who should have won National Player of the Year. And then Yogi Ferrell, who went through all the ups and downs. And that's what's special about being a fan, is getting to see those guys mature and develop over time. I mean, watching Romeo this year has been really fun, but you don't have the connection to him you had to a Yogi or to a Juwan or one of these other guys where they're there multiple years, and you get to see them not only physically change, but mentally and emotionally just grow up and mature and change as people. And that's what's rewarding to me as a fan, is seeing that maturity and you know, seeing Juwan now. He kind of always had maturity, and he's always had that Barry White, you know, deep bass voice. But he's a different guy now than he was when he stepped on campus. Same attitude, but certainly a different person.
Yep. Now, and, you know, plenty more to talk about with that. Getting back to the game, and we'll talk more about Juwan, we'll talk more about Romeo, because I thought both of those guys were really good. But I think before we get out of this first segment, we got to talk about Devonte Green, because this was another really, really good performance by him. He scored 16 points, was 6 of 8 from the field, 4 of 5 from the line, didn't have any assists, but did, you know, still had a couple nice post feeds down to Deron that I remember, you know, only had one turnover. And I thought when Indiana really needed some offense, especially there at the end of the first half, when you had a lot of guys sitting with fouls, Justin Smith, Juwan Morgan, Rob Finnessy, all sitting with fouls, he really stepped up. And it continues this stretch of strong play for him where, you know, again, I don't know what happened to turn around the attitude of Justin Smith and Devonte Green, but I'm just glad it did, because it has coincided with this team playing so much better. And this was another game in which, you know, the offense really led the way. And that's the second straight game where, you know, the defense has slipped a little bit, but you almost haven't noticed because the offense has been so good. And Andy, you know, you look at the numbers, Indiana's adjusted offensive efficiency is now 58th, which doesn't sound good, except when you remember that 2 weeks ago it was in the hundreds. I mean, that's the kind of change that this team has made offensively. And so much of it has been because Devonte Green and Justin Smith have become so much more efficient. So, you know, a quieter day today for Justin, but Devonte Green, you know, really just from a scoring perspective and taking care of the basketball, was really superb today.
Yeah, he was a huge lift. As you said, that end of the first half stretch was really important because IU was, you know, had Finnessy, Smith and Juwan on the bench during that stretch. He scored 8 of the last 10 and 12 of the last 17 points in the half for IU. And he really, you know, steadied things when it started to get a little bit, you know, get close and you were like, yeah, is Rutgers going to hang around? And he really kept him at arm's length over the course of that, that stretch toward the end of the half. And I thought for the most part, you know, the one turnover was a really high degree of difficulty pass into, you know, trying to swing it into Deron in the post. But other than that, he really played smart, played under control, played good defense. He's got 6 steals in the last 3 games. And his offensive ratings over the last 3 games, 161, 203 against Illinois, and 137 today, which was fantastic. And just a lot of big baskets today and really has played under control. So we've seen this from him in spurts. And you just hope that it's a streak that can last a little bit longer than potentially some of the others have. But he really... really held the team in the game when it got close and allowed them to really be able to turn to the bench. I think that's what's, you know, been as important as anything in these last handful of games, is the ability to give guys rest here and there and not have a drop off in play when guys come in. And you go back to what we said at the beginning of the season about how deep this team was going to be, and you just hadn't seen it. I guess in some ways you saw it because they, you know, you had to see it with so many guys injured and banged up, but I think you're starting to see again what this staff looked forward to at the beginning of the season, and the ability to have so many guys that can step in and step up. And I thought Devonte was a good example of that today. Had a really good game that will assuredly be, overshadowed by how well Juwan played and the fact that it was his senior day, but a good call by you to make sure we talk about it early, because he was really fantastic when it mattered a lot late in the first half.
Ryan?
Yeah, I look, 16 points in 21 minutes for Devonte, and he didn't make a three. Those were, shots inside three. You could see him getting hot and hitting a couple threes and doing that, but to actually put in the work that he put in to get fouled, get to the line, go 4 or 5 from the free throw line, and then 6 of 8 from the field, driving, getting inside, whatever he was doing was working. And here's the thing, is that I don't know what it was that made he and Justin Smith buy in, but that's what they did. They bought in after that Minnesota game. And since then, both of them have at the very least been steady, and at best have been really good, and have been a huge part of what Indiana's doing. So kudos to those guys, because those are two guys we've been harder on, as hard on as anybody, and they have stepped up. And Justin Smith, again, as you mentioned, didn't have a huge day today, but 5 points, 5 rebounds, 3 assists, didn't really take bad shots. He took 2 threes. One of them was wide open. One of them I didn't love, but, one bad shot in the game, I'm not going to get upset about that. And I felt like some of his misses were productive misses. When you're missing inside, 5 feet, your teammates have a chance to get a rebound and a putback and things like that. That I consider that a productive miss when it's not a bad shot.
3 assists also for him.
Yeah.
Was, the confidence and the kind of being locked in was still there.
He's moving the ball. And it's not – when he gets the ball, you don't think, oh, God.
When you get the mic?
Exactly. Yeah. fans love me. What are you talking about? The people have spoken many times. But no, I think that those two guys have bought in that along with Rob Finnessy returning. And Rob only had 5 points today in 24 minutes, but he had 4 assists, 3 rebounds, knocked down a big three. It's not necessarily always about scoring. It's about being connected to the rest of the team. And when you say that Smith and Finnessy only had 10 points, you think, Ron Davis only had 7. You think, how was this game? Well, the ball moved. It was fluid. This team looked great offensively, and these guys put together some really nice possessions throughout the game, getting guys open, getting good looks, and then getting the ball, feeding Juwan when he was on fire. So I really think that the offense just looks differently since that Minnesota game. They have bought in, and that's what it is, and that along with Rob Finnessy coming back has made everybody better.
Yep. All right, coming up as we continue our breakdown of Indiana's victory over Rutgers, we'll point out today's meaningful moments that you might have missed, and then we will go inside the numbers to highlight some important statistical notes from this game. There's some really interesting numbers in this game. We'll talk about them. You are listening to The Assembly Call. Stick with us. You're listening to the Assembly Call IU Postgame Show. I'm Jerod Morris here with Andy Bottoms and Ryan Phillips, and we are breaking down Indiana's 16-point victory over Rutgers as the Hoosiers win their fourth in a row, move to 17-14, and give themselves a legit fighting chance to make the NCAA tournament as we head into the Big Ten tournament. Guys, before we talk about some of the numbers, and there's some really interesting ones, let's talk about some meaningful moments folks might have missed. There's two I want to talk about right off the bat. One, when it happened, I thought could be really meaningful. Fortunately, it didn't end up being too bad for Indiana, but there was a stretch early in the second half, and I thought it was so important early in the second half that Indiana get off to a good start. Don't give Rutgers hope, because they can ugly up a game, get it in foul trouble, and they can, just kind of hang around until the end. They're not going to go away. You have to put them away. And Indiana had a chance to put him away early. It was 50-38. Rob got a wide-open three-pointer, missed it. On the next possession in transition, Justin Smith got a wide-open dunk. Well, it wasn't wide-open. There was a guy right there, but he still should have made it. It was a great pass by Romeo in transition. He missed it. Should have gone up with 2 hands. Went up with 1. And, it was 5 points that you could have had that would have made it a 17-point lead. We didn't get them. Rutgers goes down, gets an offensive rebound, scores, and it's 50-40 with 17:05 to go. And I thought, all right, we may be in for a dogfight. What changed was Juwan Morgan got back in the game and absolutely took over and extended the lead back to 20, which I talked about in the banner moment. So this did not end up hurting Indiana. They ended up having the hammer, but that was one of those stretches. You know, it's kind of the thing that Indiana's been missing a little bit offensively this year, which is the guy to step up and hit the big three when you can go on a run. You know, you got to have that dunk. But again, they were able to overcome that. So it didn't end up being too big of a deal today. The one that I want to focus on is going back to the first half, about 10 and a half minutes left in the first half. And there was, I think there was a deflection, and so the ball is kind of rolling around about 30 feet from the basket. And both Race Thompson and Deron Davis dove on the floor for the ball. I think Deron ended up being the one to get it. And on that possession, like, Race was, you know, battling for position and didn't let Rutgers enter the ball into the post because he was playing such tough physical defense. And, you know, anyway, so he denies the pass. Deron ends up getting on the floor to get the loose ball. We get it. And what I loved about that play, Ryan, and what I think is, you know, one of the biggest differences between this Rutgers game and the last one is when you have two big physical guys who come in and play hard for every second that they're on the court, which Deron and Race do, it just infuses your team with an added attitude and added size and physicality and just the ability to withstand some foul trouble from Juwan Morgan, which is one of the things that we couldn't do during the losing streak. So there's a long list of reasons why Indiana is playing better now. It should not go unnoticed the importance of Deron and Race and how physical they play, how hard they play, and the attitude they bring, because it almost always seems to give Indiana kind of an emotional lift when they come in and they help the Hoosiers absorb foul trouble to Justin and Juwan. So I thought that play was indicative of what those two guys bring to the floor.
Yeah, and you look at Race Thompson today. He took two threes. One was a force late in the shot clock, and one was an in-rhythm three that, quite frankly, I think next year he's going to make, but his shot is just so off from missing so much time. It takes you a long time to sort of rebuild things.
I'm glad he felt comfortable taking it.
I agree. Though
it shows that he's a little bit more comfortable on the court, which I liked.
I agree. But he had three rebounds in 11 minutes. And yeah, with a guy like Race Thompson and a guy like Deron Davis on the floor, you're not going to get pushed around. And that's the thing, is Indiana was pushed around throughout Big Ten play in January and February. They were just shoved around and they were beaten up. And Juwan Morgan, God love him, as he said in his senior speech, he hates that this you know, coaching staff makes him play the five. And there's a reason. He's undersized for that position, but he's so good finishing around the hoop. That's where you want him. But, you know, to have a guy like Race, to have a guy like Deron Davis, to be able next year when a guy puts some pounds on, a guy like Jake Forrester, or maybe even Clifton Moore, if he's able to put on some weight and get in the game more, you're not going to get beaten up. And if you look at that Minnesota game, what happened to Indiana was they got beaten up and just got absolutely shoved around and outmanned at every position. You're not going to get that when Deron Davis and Race Thompson are being effective and you've got Juwan Morgan and you've got, you know, look, say what you want about Devonte Green being small, but he's a tough guy. And you got Al Durham, who's a guy who's just going to get in your face and defend you a certain way and use his length to harass your shots. And I mean, so when you go up and down that lineup, you're looking at a group of guys, and even Rob Finnessy to a degree is not going to get fazed by a guy bumping him or tough play. He's just a steady player. And so it's a different makeup of this team than it was a few weeks ago. And when you have guys who can give you effective minutes, who aren't going to get shoved around and aren't going to be sort of cowed by the moment, it really changes the entire makeup of your team. And that's what we're seeing from Indiana. I mean, let's dial back and look at what's happened here. They've won four straight. They're quite frankly playing as well as anybody in the Big Ten right now. I mean, they took Purdue down to the wire and lost by two at home. One bounce goes another way. They can win that game. They swept Michigan State. I mean, there is not a team right now they can't beat in the Big Ten. Obviously they'll get their chance to prove that next week, or this week. I don't know, matchup wise, if there are certain teams I don't want to face, that's probably true. And I'm not going to say them on the air because I know that's how we're going to wind up playing them. But, I just think that right now this team has turned a corner, and it's turned a corner because it's not getting pushed around, because the team is connected like it was early in November and December when they were playing like a unit. If you look back, and I've gone back, I rewatched the Marquette game, the offense was moving like it is now, and things were getting open and guys were working and playing together and connected the way they are now. that just got lost for a while. And it's inexcusable that it got lost. And you know, there are reasons for it and all that stuff. But we're past that now. We're at a point where these guys are playing really well and trying to earn their way into the tournament. And so far, kudos to these guys for playing their tails off. They could have mailed in the season after Minnesota, and they did not. They have turned this around by playing harder, playing smarter, and just believing in and relying on each other. And it's really worked.
Yeah, two quick things here on those. One of the things Archie said in the postgame was we're not so restricted with our lineup anymore. I feel like our bench has really been a good boost here in the last four or five games. I mean, that speaks to what you said, and Ryan. And then, Jerod, that stretch you mentioned in the second half also it coincided with when IU really blew the game open, finally pushed the lead up to 20. It was funny. I was sitting there at home with my younger daughter, and we were watching the game. I was like, if they can find a way to push this to 20, you know, they had gotten it to 14 and couldn't do it or whatever. Well, she's meanwhile like counting how many more points they got to get it to 20. And actually, it went pretty quickly during that stretch. And it actually, coincided with IU's best defensive stretch of the second half before Rutgers scored exclusively on free throws for a lengthy period of time. But, you talked about that stretch where Justin missed the dunk. There was a turnover up in the next possession after that. Romeo got a free throw. And then Al scored a 3-point play. Romeo missed inside. Finnessy made that three off of a good kick out from Romeo. Juwan had an and one. Justin missed that three that was, you know, not necessarily a great shot. Juwan had another and one. Then Juwan made that three that you talked about. I mean, that stretch right there, IU had 15 points in, I think, seven possessions, maybe six or seven possessions, and really only allowed during the same stretch. I think Rutgers scored twice in, eight, 9 or 10. Possessions as well. So that was really the stretch that blew the game open and, started with a couple of timely plays. And I'm sure we'll get to Al, but I thought that was a good drive and a good take from him. I thought he was better going to the basket today than he had been in the past.
Yeah, I thought Al Durham, man, he scored 9 tough points today. I mean, he got battered to the ground, made his free throws. He was 5 for 5. It was nice to see him, I thought, really being smartly aggressive, not overly so. I thought maybe like, his first drive of the game was probably a little bit early. I don't think Archie liked it. But other than that, I thought he was really smartly and smartly aggressive and really tough all game long. Let's go inside the numbers. A lot of interesting numbers today. You know, Indiana has been a team that when they have scored well, it typically has coincided with really good shooting nights from three-point range. Today, Indiana, 4 of 18 from downtown. So not making the threes, 22%. I mean, it's been an issue all season long. But, I thought they didn't force a lot of the threes. I mean, I thought a lot of those came out of the offense. Where they really did the work was the free throw line. 23 of 29 from the line, 79% as the Hoosiers continue to get, better and better making their free throws. And the big number that jumps out from an offensive standpoint, 6 turnovers. It's amazing what happens, Andy, when the ball moves and you've got all your guys and you've got chemistry and you're just not turning it over. I mean, you get more shots that way. You get more attempts at the basket. Passes. Yeah. And Rob Finnessy obviously is a steadying presence, but guys who have been erratic their whole careers, like Devonte Green, not doing it anymore. Not trying to make some of the crazy passes. The one guy who did try to make kind of a crazy pass was Al Durham when he threw that little alley-oop type thing to Devonte, which was kind of an ill-advised pass, but Devonte got it, somehow made it. So, Indiana's ability to take care of the ball has really been huge for the offensive efficiency, because the Hoosiers aren't going to get a lot of efficiency from behind the line, so they have to do it by limiting mistakes and playing to their strengths. And when they're reducing turnovers like they are, it really allows them to do that.
Yeah, if you look over the last few games, the 8.6 turnover percentage, and it's worth pointing out, one of the turnovers was when Johnny Jaeger basically ran the shot clock out at the end of the game. So really only 5 when it actually mattered. So the number's even better than what you said. 8.6 turnover percentage this game, 10.5 the last one, 13.4, 16.7 against Wisconsin. Even most of the others, 15.5 against Iowa. The Purdue game was bad because that was, rip your eyes out, watching that from an offensive standpoint. But, really have taken good care of the ball. That was something else that Archie mentioned after the game. And you touched on the three-point shooting. The inverse of that was how well they shot from two. They were 27 of 40, which is 67.5% on twos, 13 of 19 from two in the second half.
In the season again.
Yeah, and as you said, shot the ball really well from the free throw line, had 48 points in the paint, so that speaks a lot to that two-point percentage in those big numbers. So that's, I think, 100 points in the paint over the last two games. I think it was 52 against Illinois. So they're – they're making it easy on themselves. And exactly what
you
said.
That's how they won early in the year, though.
Absolutely, it is. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. No, it is.
The number for me was the bench points, 25. I know Rutgers had 31, but IU had 25. Yeah, a couple weeks ago, we were getting 6 points from the bench in a game, 4 points, 2 points. And now that you move Devonte Green to the bench, you've got some scoring there. Deron Davis starting to come through more from the bench. Evan Fitzner had a layup today. I mean, you're just getting more from those guys, and it eases pressure offensively when other guys have to go out because of foul trouble or just for rest. You don't have these dead periods that you had anymore because you've got effective guys who started before on the bench. And then, you know, again, a guy like Race Thompson comes in and just kind of creates some havoc for you. That opens some things up. It just feels like a more connected team. Starters, bench players, whatever, these guys are all in there to contribute. And that's part of the change. Also, I thought, where is the fast break points? We won that battle again, 14-7. It's not a whole lot of fast break points, but you win the battle on fast break points. It means you're getting back on defense, and it means that you're taking advantage of the opportunities when they're there.
You know, on the negative side, Andy, you know, Rutgers scores 1.123 points per possession, which isn't great, you know, because they're not a great offensive team, and it's the second straight game that Indiana's defense hasn't been quite as strong against an offense that isn't as great. You know, today it wasn't 3-point shooting. Indiana, for the most part, did a good job defending the 3-point line, only gave up 14 attempts, you know, in a game where Rutgers needed to shoot threes to come back. You know, outside of, I thought, a couple of lapses early in the game, Indiana really tightened up its 3-point coverage in the second half, but you gave up 30 free throws and Rutgers made 23 of them. And that's where a lot of the scoring was. So, you know, I'm like slightly concerned about the defense, very, very slightly the last two games. You know, it's almost like because the offense is better, they're playing with a little less desperation on defense because they don't have to, you know, just to like stay in games. So, and I think that's fine because the net gain of obviously the offense has just, you know, has taken this team's play just to the next level. But I also, today, like, I don't know that there's a lot to be concerned about just because like the game flow and the way it was being called. I mean, they went from the first 5 minutes of the game not calling any fouls to like calling 50 fouls over the rest of the game. And when Rutgers does so much of their damage from the free throw line and there were so many questionable calls, it's like, all right, you know, look, we'll see what kind of defense this team brings to the Big Ten tournament. They've ridden the back of their defense to this stronger play. So I'm not as concerned about the defense as you might be when you see 1.123 points per possession given up to Rutgers simply because of how the game flow went.
Yeah, I think the free throws are such a big part of that. There was a while that Rutgers didn't score. I mean, basically every possession was either a turnover or shooting free throws for like a 10 possession stretch at one point in the second half. And with some of that stuff, it's just kind of how the game is called. As you said, there weren't any fouls for the first, I think, about 540. And then over the next 26 minutes, there was 40 fouls called. I just don't, at that point, you really can't establish any kind of rhythm on either end of the floor. And so to me, that's not super alarming. I think the one area that IU did really well with against Rutgers in the first game, did well to start the game, and then struggled a little bit as the game went on, was allowing some second chance points and offensive rebounds. That to me was a more alarming area, although part of that is just how physical Rutgers is and the size that they have inside, and the relative lack of size that IU has, you know, up front outside of what Deron would bring. So I think if there's something to be concerned about, I'm less concerned about the fouling and more so about that. I will say it looks like for now, IU's free throw defense, despite allowing 76.7% from the line today, it does appear that IU still owns the number one free throw defense in the nation. So
going to finish the regular season at number one, baby.
By 0.6% over Alabama A&M. So,
man, yeah.
Hanging tough.
Everybody really going to be watching that SWAC tournament to see if how Alabama A&M's free throw defense is, see if we can hold on.
By the way, just so everybody's clear, we talk about that ironically. Like, people sometimes tweet me like we're saying that seriously, like they're playing good free throw defense.
We're idiots for a lot of reasons, but that isn't one of them.
Yeah. Just to be clear, it's a joke.
I think when you look at 48 fouls called in this game, you're going to get a lot of free throws. And here's the thing. You look at the second half stats. Rutgers was 10 of 25 from the field. That's 40%. They were 1 of 6 from 3, which is 16.7%. But they were 16 of 20 from the free throw line. So they got 16 points there. And so I do think that it's hard also when you're up big to sell out defensively. I don't know. I can hear the people saying now, you should sell out defensively on every play. Well, when you're up big, you don't want to risk fouling. You don't want to risk, you know, doing anything that's going to cause it. If a guy gets a wide open layup and you're up 20, just let him have it. You don't want to risk a 3-point play and potentially giving them some momentum. I mean, you know, guys do get lost in a game sometimes. I felt like that happened a little bit at Illinois too. Guys just kind of got lost in the game and they're ready to run out on offense before you complete your box out, you know, your block out on defense. It's not excusable, but it happens and we all know it happens. So let's, you know, you kind of don't feel as bad about it. I mean, when you're scoring 90 points or 89 points, you don't feel as bad. Now,
you just don't want to get in bad habits. I completely
agree with you. But in a game where the game flow is different, I don't think this team's going to have a problem turning on the defense. We've seen them do it against two better teams in Wisconsin and Michigan State and really, you know, sort of nutting up defensively and getting it done. And that's what matters to me. It doesn't matter how they played against Rutgers in the second half and especially when they're shooting that many free throws. I mean, Rutgers hit 7 free throws in the first half and made 16 in the second. I mean, IU, you know, got 29 free throws of their own. So we can't really complain about that disparity. It just game flow wise, it was kind of a tough game to watch at times. So
yeah, it was equally ugly on both sides.
For sure. It just seemed like every possession for a while, they were just blowing the whistle. And again, an early game on a Sunday, you're going to get some sloppiness. But instead of having sloppiness with turnovers in this one, you had sloppiness on the fouls. And I thought a lot of them, you know, were legit calls. It's just kind of, it's the Big Ten, let them play, was kind of the attitude.
That's how Rutgers wants to play. So, I mean, to a certain extent, you've got to get that under control.
Yeah.
So
and they never really did today. I mean, the officials never really got them to stop that. I will say Andy was mentioning the second chance points. That was really my only concern from the game today. But that's just what Rutgers does. They're an offensive rebounding team. They'll go get offensive rebounds.
Let me add some context to that, because they got
you by 4 too.
When they got 11 offensive rebounds, which you look at and you can be like, that's not good. And there were a couple of times where, you know, Indiana just had some slippage in its focus on the defensive glass, you know, some poor blockout technique, but Rutgers still rebounded less than 30% of their misses. And for the season, they rebound 33.5% of their misses. They're one of the best offensive rebounding teams in the country. So it wasn't good. I'm sure Archie's going to be frustrated by some of them, but we still,
all they worked on last night, he said.
Yeah. But you know, you still basically took one of Rutgers' biggest strengths and held them to less than what they normally do. So
particularly
in the
first half when IU seemed to dominate the boards for about the first 10 minutes, and that's when they got out to their lead, you know, and so it felt like in the second half, Rutgers got back to doing what they wanted to do, but it was too late at that point, I thought.
Yep. Okay. As we move forward here on the Assembly Call, we continue our breakdown of Indiana's victory over Rutgers. We've got several other topics to discuss. We need to talk a little bit more about Juwan's game, a little bit more about Romeo, and then what we alluded to earlier, the strong game from Al Durham, and another good game from Rob. We'll discuss all of that and more. Stick with us on the Assembly Call. You're listening to the Assembly Call IU Postgame Show. Catch us live immediately following every IU basketball game, plus every Thursday night at our website, assemblycall.com. And while you're there, make sure you sign up for the free IU Hoops email newsletter that we send out. Over 6,000 of your fellow IU fans are subscribed. It'll make you a smarter and more well-informed IU basketball fan. I'm Jerod Morris. I'm here with Andy Bottoms and Ryan Phillips. We're breaking down Indiana's 16-point victory over Rutgers. Guys, let's hit, you know, some of the storylines from this game that we haven't really talked about yet. I want to talk a little bit more about Romeo Langford here to start, Andy, because, you know, if this is his last, you know, time playing at Simon Scott Assembly Hall, and I think we all agree that the only chance that he would play at Simon Scott Assembly Hall again is for an unfortunate NIT home game. But I thought it was a really strong performance for him. 20 points. I thought he did a nice job rebounding with 6 rebounds, 2 assists. I thought he played tough defense. You know, he was matched up on Ron Harper for a lot of the day, who really played well against Indiana last time. And Harper made some plays, had a few rebounds, but overall was 4-for-10, only 8 points. You know, and there was an offensive rebound late in the first half that I thought just really showed some of the growth in Romeo, some of the toughness. You know, this was not a pretty game for Romeo, But I feel like maybe even a few weeks ago, you know, you think back to that Purdue game, the first game at Purdue, which was kind of a tough game, and he didn't really respond to that well, started forcing shots, you know, didn't really get much going. And today, you know, even though it was tough for him to get clean looks, I thought after kind of a slow start, which is typical for him, he likes to ease his way into games, he really asserted himself, got himself to the free throw line, played tough defense, rebounded. And so, you know, if this was his last game at Simon Scott Assembly Hall, it was a good way for him to go out because he really played a strong game. And I think it shows that he's really maturing here as we end his freshman year. And we're seeing what we thought we'd see, you know, in a game like this where he and Juwan lead. You've got a lot of good role players doing their thing, you know, around them. And that's the ticket for this team to make some noise in the Big Ten tournament and in potentially the NCAA tournament moving forward.
Yeah, I did think it was a little bit of a slow start. I also just think Juwan was playing so well that I don't want to say he didn't need to, but I think there were fewer opportunities for that at the beginning. He was the last of the five starters to score, and I don't think he took a shot.
Yep.
Till I think just under the 12-minute mark. But I thought what he showed in the beginning of the second half, where they basically isolated him and tried to get him in the post, he got fouled. He ended up shooting, I think, five free throws in the second half. I thought he was better at driving for the most part in the second half than he was at times in the first. And especially given the way that this game was being called, we can lament that as much as we want, but you've got to adjust a little bit to how the game's being called and really try to attack. And I thought there were times late in the first half where they got away from that a little bit. And Devonte bailed him out with a couple big shots. But overall, thought a solid performance. He showed some flashes defensively of, you know, had a nice block shot, at least one, where he played well that way. And I thought really played within the flow of the game overall. You know, picked his spots, asserted himself where he needed to, and is turning into, you know, we've seen the progression in the three-point shooting, but had a couple really nice ones in catch-and-shoot situations today that were really good in rhythm. You're starting to see him get some more confidence there, which is a good thing. And another solid performance from him from the free-throw line is, you know, his percentage is, you know, he's 8 for 10 today, has continued to creep up to where it's, you know, 72% right now. And if you think about where that was at the beginning, and people were a little bit worried about that. So he's done a lot of work there and really improved in that regard as well.
Yeah, you know, and I think, Ryan, you know, to continue this about Romeo and Juwan, you know, because you've been someone who, you know, when Indiana has struggled, has really wanted those two guys to assert themselves. And I think one of the things that we've seen from Juwan is, like Romeo, he sometimes likes to ease himself into games, you know, and I think part of this is a bad habit that he got into when Indiana's bench was so thin and he couldn't pick up fouls. You know, it's almost like he kind of tried to relax a little bit early, not pick up fouls. Let me just get through the first 6-8 minutes of the game. But he wouldn't be as aggressive rebounding, wouldn't be as aggressive offensively. And maybe part of that too is just the emphasis of the offense early in the game. You know, today the emphasis was really to get it to him, and he was great, you know, because, you know, just as recently as the Michigan State game and even in the Illinois game, I thought he really struggled early in the game. This is what you want to see from him, where you come out on a mission from the tip, set the tone, and then let the other guys kind of start filling in around. So, you know, time will tell if this was kind of a one-day thing because it was senior day, and, you know, we'll have to see how he approaches the Big Ten tournament game. But, man, this is the template for this team. You know, establish him early, do it in both halves, because that seems to me like when Indiana's at their best in terms of how they start halves is when they play through him. And, you know, I know he got into some foul trouble today, but, you know, now you've got more of a bench to kind of absorb that. So, man, just whatever minutes you're out there, go for it now, because Durant can come in, Race can come in. If you do happen to pick up fouls, try not to, but be aggressive from the tip, because it really changes the complexion of Indiana's team at the start of games when Juwan plays like this.
Yeah, and certainly I think that that has to be, and we were talking about it when they were struggling, that maybe they just needed to throw the ball, you know, set up whatever they could, just get him the ball early in games and get them off on the right foot, because they're having these slow starts. And that was, you know, they're getting down 10 points before the first media timeout and then not being able to recover. And, you know, they'd have those long lulls, and then over the rest of the game, they'd play even with the team, but they'd be starting that down 10, essentially. It's essentially giving yourself a 10-point deficit to start the game. So yeah, I think that getting him the ball, getting him some cross screens and getting him open on the block with a guy on his back is the way to go. But certainly, you know, that's not just on Juwan. There's guys that need to set screens and get him open and make sure they get him the ball when he does flash open. And they did that today. And even, you know, Devonte Green had his one turnover trying to force, you know, a pass into Juwan. Now, it was an ill-advised pass, but if you're turning the ball over because you're trying to get the ball to your best player in the position he does the best at, I'll be okay with that. I mean, as long as you're not throwing that pass seven or eight times, if you're throwing that once and the guy might be a little bit over the top, okay, I'm fine with that turnover because you're doing the right thing. You're trying to get the ball to the guy in the right spot. About Romeo, though, I think that, yeah, this is what we've got to see from Romeo is even when the defense is set, be aggressive because you could get a foul and you could get to the line. And he's been shooting the ball so well from the line lately. We saw it against Michigan State a few times. He just went right at the defense, just went right into the teeth of the defense and got fouled. And, you know, 5 of 12 from the field today, 2 of 4 from three. I thought three of his threes were really good shots. One, I thought he kind of forced it. It was a step back. But 5 of 12 from the field, you know, I don't mind him having a bad day from the field if he's being aggressive like that, and because he's going to make up for it at the line. And that's what he did today. And so with Romeo, yeah, I think he's got to realize, look, you only have a certain amount of time left to impress scouts. Let's go get him. You know, let's go attack and attack and attack. And, you know, in this league, I don't know if there's anybody who one-on-one can guard him straight up. Now, when the rest of the team helps out, that's when you got to keep your head up and make some passes. And today I thought also he passed up what I think a couple weeks ago he would have taken as a three and moved the ball along to Rob Finnessy, and Finnessy knocked down the three. And I thought that was just a heightened awareness from Romeo. Yeah. You're starting to see it. He's moving the ball. He's not, you know, and maybe this is, you know, a lack of pressure on him as other guys are stepping up. But, you know, a couple weeks ago, he would have fired that shot. And it was nice to see him just kind of move the ball down the line to get the guy with the better look to get it. So kudos to both of those guys, Romeo and Juwan. Again, as you mentioned, I was hard on them early in the year about attacking and finding their spots. And it's not always on them, but sometimes when you get the ball with 15 seconds left on the shot clock and nothing's going offensively, you just have to attack and make something happen. And that's why you're there. So, the last couple games, they haven't really had to do that because a lot of guys have been helping out and they're getting their opportunities more in rhythm and more inside the flow of the offense. So, hopefully we continue to see that as we move forward. Cause this team does not look like a team that's done. This team looks like a team that is ready to make a move.
They look like they were reborn and are just ready to play forever. You know, and I think a big part of that is, and a big part of the offensive, you know, explosion that we've seen is being able to be multidimensional offensively. You know, you're not just playing through Juwan and Romeo. You're not just hoping for a rare good shooting game. You've got a lot of different guys going. And today, Andy, you know, Indiana got Al Durham going again. It's the first time since all the way back in the Ohio State game when he had an offensive rating of 100 or better. I mean, he's really been struggling to be efficient offensively, and a big part of it today is, you know, didn't force any shots, as we talked about, was tough driving to the basket. You know, he used the game flow to his advantage, I thought, which is, all right, I'm going to go. They're calling this. Let me get fouled. I know how to sell contact, you know, when I get fouled going to the basket. And he did, and that kid is tough as nails. I mean, he takes some hits, and I know... Okay, I think that part of his issue being consistent offensively is his fingers have been bothering him since he got hurt in that Michigan State game. You know, and he's got that splint on there, and I'm fairly certain that's been a part of the issue. He'll never say it, but I'm fairly certain that's been a part of the issue, you know, that he's kind of been going through and why his shooting has been a little bit inconsistent. But I thought we saw him today get back to doing what he's best at, which is going to the bucket and drawing contact. And in a lot of his better offensive games, you see him getting 3, 4, 5 free throw attempts. And it adds another layer. You know, when you've got, you know, Devonte and you know, playing better and Deron healthy and Rob Finnessy back, you don't necessarily need Al scoring 11, 12 points every single game. But for him to be a guy that can reliably get you 8, 9, 10 and, you know, do it at a high efficiency like he did today, that really helps Indiana's offense because you know you're going to get tough defense from him. So, you know, he's been a little bit up and down. This was a big game for him today, I thought, and hopefully a sign of things to come because he really, you know, you look at all the things that can take Indiana from kind of being where they were and become not just a team that can make a tournament but make some noise, having a guy like him as a fourth, fifth option who can do some things, you know, that really makes you multidimensional offensively.
You look back at his game log and like you said, there's a pretty strong correlation between the number of free throws he takes and how effective he really was in the game. Now, obviously because he's a reasonably good free throw shooter, that stands to reason that you're going to score well if you get to the line and you shoot it well. But I think it just shows the aggressiveness that you want to see from him. And I think for the most part, he was able to be effectively aggressive. And so I think today, as you said, he really, looked at how the game was being called, took advantage of what was going on, and got to the line five times, made all five, shot well from the free throw line against Illinois as well. And I think one of his threes was halfway down and came out. I don't remember the second one, but you know, that's one of the areas that he struggled a little bit. And I think you can see
he overshot his other one.
I think it was one of the ones that was way long.
An air ball or back rim. And kept going.
Yeah, the other one rattled in and out. So, you know, he's two of his last 10 from three. So those are things that you want to see him get sorted out. But I agree, Jerod, it probably has at least something to do with, you know, the injury he had in the Michigan State game. Because really after that, his free throw shooting or his 3-point shooting has struggled. But it was a good balanced game for him. And I think you've got a good rotation of guards now. If he continues to play that way, and if Devonte plays the way that he has, you've really got, you know, those three in the backcourt plus Romeo that gives you some guys with different looks and can do some different things. And Rob today was, you know, the fouls really, I feel like took him out of the rhythm of the game early. Not necessarily that he even played poorly, but just didn't get to play as much. And Devonte really stepped up for him today, but still had four assists in 24 minutes, which is certainly a good number. Stepped into the three and knocked it down that we talked about. But I just thought it was a game that, you know, got out of his rhythm, and played smarter as the game went on defensively, and ended up with only three. But the second foul he got, I think Jess Sells mentioned, it was just kind of a silly one, because, you know, he just got tangled up with somebody inside, kind of threw his hands up and did the old, well, I'm going to throw my hands up to make it look like I didn't do anything, which makes it look like you did do something, kind of went from there. So yeah, it was kind of an up and down game from him, but he's certainly been more good than bad. And I thought all those guys did a really good job at disrupting Geo Baker, who we have terrible memories of from the Big Ten tournament last year. But I thought they really got into him and made his life difficult, made him take some tough shots. Even one of the threes he did make in the first half was just a, you know, almost fall away, step back as the shot clock ran out. So I do think defensively those guys have brought it. It's just a matter of, who's going to be the one picking up the offensive slack on any given night.
Yeah, and, you know, Ryan, again, you know, those two guys plus Romeo and Devonte, who do the majority of the ball handling for Indiana, three total turnovers between them, which is, you know, just shows their decision-making and their poise on that end.
Well, when Al is at his best is when he swings it through off a reversal and just goes to the rim. And that's what you saw today, and he was willing to get fouled. And, I think that, you know, with Al, when he's being aggressive like that, he's so athletic, and I hate this term, but he's sneaky athletic. Like, you look at him and you know he's got the long arms and everything like that, but he also has some explosion that you don't see all the time out of him. And getting to the line, and I feel comfortable with him at the line. I mean, I really do. He's a guy who knocks down shots. He just does. And, you know, if Al Durham's getting you 9 points, it's a good day. And he's certainly capable of getting up to like 15, 16, but if he's getting you nine, you know, the offense is working because it means he's getting driving lanes.
Yep.
Or reversals and open shots. So,
yeah. Okay. Coming up in our final segment, we hand out our game ball. That'll be an easy one. We'll hit some other storylines. And of course, we will talk to Andy about bracketology. What does this do for Indiana? What needs to happen for them to make a tournament? That's next on the Assembly Call. Stick with us. Listening to the Assembly Call IU Postgame Show. I'm Jerod Morris. I'm here with Andy Bottoms and Ryan Phillips, and we are wrapping up our breakdown of Indiana's 16-point victory over Rutgers as the Hoosiers move to 17-14, 8-12 in the conference, and secure a bye in the Big Ten tournament. The Hoosiers will play on Thursday in the 8-9 game. We still have to wait and see who they will be playing. But gentlemen, this brings us to the point in the show when we hand out our game balls, and this is another one where there are so many reasonable options because a lot of guys had good games, but I'm fairly certain we're all going in the same direction. My game ball is going to Juwan Morgan for the way he started the game, for the way that he put Indiana on his back in the second half when, you know, it felt like Rutgers might be ready to make a run, and he just ended any thoughts of that. It was one of the best performances of his career. It came in a big spot, and huge tip of the cap to Juwan Morgan for a great game today and a great career as a Hoosier. Andy, who's getting your game ball today?
Yeah, definitely Juwan for me. It's you know, one of the things we didn't talk about in the opening was it's great to see him, you know, play basketball so well, but just seems to be a really interesting young man to you know, to follow and to look at. There's a couple of really good stories about him, one by Zach Osterman and one by I think Mike Miller had the one in the Herald Times that talked about both his you know, military upbringing, and then his older brother was in the Herald Times one. Really, really good stuff. Just really a great showing of his maturity and who he is as a person, which is we don't get to see as much as we might, you know, like to or want to, because we follow these guys so much as basketball players. But Archie had another good quote about him, so I'll throw this in here. I think the one thing about Juwan is he's an adult. From very early on, he's been a mature guy. He's so coachable. When it comes to asking him to do what other guys don't want to do, he does it. At the end of the day, he's become a very, very quality leader. So on a day when your coach does something like that and you score 25 points in 22 minutes, hard to give the game ball to anybody else.
Ryan?
Yeah, it's Juwan. Come on, guys. There's no suspense here. I think hat tips have to go to Romeo Langford, who I thought really did a great job kind of closing the game down with his free throw shooting and with just kind of commanding it. And Devonte Green for having the best game we've seen from him in a while. You know, he's been playing better, but certainly offensively to go 6 of 8 from the field, 4 or 5 from the free throw line and be very engaged. And also, you know, one thing I saw from Devonte when he came out of the game, I remember a couple weeks ago, some people pointed out that maybe he had some fake enthusiasm when he came out of the game, and Archie didn't take kindly to that. Today, he came out of the game, he slapped 5 with everybody on that, was smiling, seemed to be just having fun. And that's the thing about these last 4 games. These guys are enjoying themselves. And you know, it's easy to enjoy watching guys enjoy themselves, you know, in this, you know, in this forum, and getting to watch, you know, Juwan Morgan all smiles on his senior day was certainly rewarding to all of us, I think. So 25 points, 7 rebounds, and that's while battling foul trouble, hit a 3, 2 of 2 from the free throw line. And to do all that in just 22 minutes. Yeah, that's a Juwan Morgan game ball, certainly. He deserved it. And, you know, game ball for the career too. The guy's been amazing. While I hope we don't see him play another home game at IU again, because that would mean that, things don't work out as far as the NCAA tournament is concerned. You know, it's sad to see him leave that court and, you know, not be headed back onto it. So, let's go win some games in the Big Ten tournament, get this guy in the NCAA tournament and, you know, to cap off his career the right way.
Also, a quick honorable mention to Zach McRoberts, who played 4 minutes, had 2 rebounds and assist, saved several possessions for Indiana. Just more Zach McRoberts things. And we're going to miss that next year. I mean, he has battled injuries this year, so he hasn't been, you know, the lockdown defender that he was last year. But, man, that guy, just in terms of leadership by example and what he's meant in the transition from Tom Crean to Archie Miller has been huge. And, you know, we didn't talk about him a lot today. I haven't talked about him a lot on recent shows, but he's really going to be missed. And I thought he showed today in just 4 minutes a lot of the reasons why he's going to be missed, because he's not always the guy who gets the bucket, not always the guy who gets the assist, but sometimes he's the guy that saves the possession to even give you a chance to score. And you need guys like that. Ultimate glue guy. So we'll miss Zach McRoberts as well.
And all right, Andy. I did think it was funny during his senior speech where he said, where he mentioned the trainers and thanked them and then said, boy, I really wish I hadn't spent so much time with you guys this year. But
yeah,
I mean, it's true. You know, so Zach really obviously not the senior year he expected, but stuck with it. And he's always going to be one of those guys we look back on fondly.
All right, Andy, the only reason people are still listening is because they want to hear from you. bracketology stuff. So, you know, the questions, you started getting questions after the Wisconsin win when it still seemed a little bit ridiculous to be asking them. And the idea was always, okay, look, Indiana's got to win out in the regular season. Indiana won out 17-14. You know, we've talked before, you probably got to get to 18 to have a real chance. 19, you feel really good about it in terms of wins. What needs to happen now in the Big Ten tournament, and what has maybe happened around Indiana on the bubble that has shifted things at all over the last few days?
Yeah, I think one of the things that is hard to convey is that this is going to feel like a cop-out, but there's not a set checklist that you got to be able to hit in order to do it, because it's always dependent upon what the other teams are doing around you that are in the bubble, and dependent on bid thieves or whatever. So I'm always hesitant to say like, oh, win. Everybody wants you to say like, win 2 more games and you're in. It's not like there's a finish line where you've like, I've won 2 more games and I've surpassed this, you know, this set mark that I have to get in order to do it. So I guess I would start with that. So for one, absolutely have to, in my eyes, have to win at least one of the Big Ten tournament. You look at either, whether it's Ohio State or Minnesota, those are both teams that are in the NCAA tournament conversation. Not sure where they are in the net as of today, but probably likely both on the border of like a quad one or quad two win based on a neutral court game there. Winning would then set you up to play Michigan State again, if I'm understanding the Big Ten bracket correctly. So,
yep.
You know, cue the hard to beat a team three times in a season people out there for that to be said. But yeah, I think the way this team has done it and kind of taking it one game at a time, I think one is a minimum. Jerry Palm had an interesting post. I think it was yesterday. It kind of talked about some of the historical precedent of teams that have gotten in, and would encourage people to go out and read that. And many of the things don't necessarily bode well for IU this season. Every season is unique, but it does give at least some historical guidance of, you know, these are typically been good indicators in the past versus what they are. So I think that's important. The committee chair, I guess, was on at halftime of the Cincinnati and Houston game today, and made some comment to the effect of being, you know, really diligent about understanding, you know, guys or coaches that had missed games at different points and trying to take that into account, which they always do. It may have only just been in relation to Zion Williamson, because I'm not sure that any other injuries in college basketball. Because
everything in college basketball is in relation to Zion Williamson.
College basketball is something that everything else revolves around. So yeah, you can't.
They are crushing a beautiful thing. To that. In Zion Williamson, the media is crushing a beautiful thing. Like, he is so much fun to watch, and he's so good, and they're just making it so unwatchable.
I separate it. I love Zion. I hate all the other stuff.
It's hard not to. And he's, you know what I'll say about him? He's a kid who could have shut it down and quit. He could have quit Duke, and he wants to go win a national title. So all hats off to him. I hope he doesn't do it, but all hats off to him for sticking with it. He's a good kid.
So in terms of answering your other question about other teams around them on the bubble, which is probably the easier one to answer. If you look at yesterday, you know, Florida losing helps. Seton Hall winning did not. NC State winning, it kind of helps. I think they play Clemson in the first round of their first game of the ACC tournament. That's a potential, you know, elimination type game where one of them is going to get another loss. They're both right around the cut line. That's a tough one to me. I mean... They swept Lipscomb. They did win at UCLA, which I think they thought would be a bigger win earlier on. But they have a couple quad three losses, so it
while hurts there. UCLA's players were actively trying to get Steve Alford fired, I believe.
That's speculation. It could be there, but you know. So I think it's
when you sweep Lipscomb, how do you not get in?
They haven't beaten. It's difficult though. I mean, I do. You know, you stand back and you look at how the deck is stacked against some of these mid-major teams and. In a season with a weak bubble, do you look at that and say, hey, maybe these guys deserve a chance to be in? The challenge for them is like those are really their most notable wins. They did win at Murray State in their other meeting. But other than that, they really don't have a whole lot of marquee wins to hang their hat on, although they do have a winning record against, you know, quadrant one and two combined, maybe even each of those individually. So I would lean toward not having them in, but I do think they're right there in that conversation at this point without digging into it a whole lot. So. Alabama, if they would lose another game in the SEC tournament, would be one that might play their way out. Texas and TCU. TCU won when they matched up yesterday. I feel like they're a little bit safer. Texas, though, is kind of fighting against history with the, you know, volume of losses and things like that. So those teams are there. You know, you'd want Temple to lose in the American. And then, like, the entire Big East is somehow associated with the bubble. So Georgetown gets a big win yesterday at Marquette. Creighton is in the mix as well. So the problem is if those teams lose, they're going to lose to another Big East team that's also kind of around the bubble. So it's a little bit hard to figure out, like, you know, make up a cheat sheet of who you should root for and against at that point, because pretty much everybody in the Big East is in a little bit of the conversation. So I think a lot of people talked about things not going well for IU in terms of the bubble yesterday. I don't necessarily think that was true. It wasn't a terrific day for them from a bubble perspective, but I don't think it was completely bad because some of the other teams did lose. So it's starting to take shape a little bit more. I think if, you know, tournament started today, I think they would have a reasonable chance to be in at this point. They've gotten to that three games over 500 mark that we've touched on. And again, if the committee takes into account some of the injuries and things like that, that's an arduous task for a team like IU that's had a revolving door of guys in and out. But I do think seeing what the team's doing now at full strength will have an impression. How much of an impression remains to be seen. But I think it gets dicey if they lose the first game in the Big Ten tournament.
Yeah, I just want to say that, forget it. Let's just go win the Big Ten tournament. This has been the opposite year where we beat Wisconsin and sweep Michigan State and lose to all the teams we should beat. Let's just go win the Big Ten tournament. Why not? Why not?
I would normally be very upset with you for saying something crazy like that about the Big Ten tournament, but I find myself feeling both exhilarated and terrified by this weird sense of confidence that I have about the Big Ten tournament.
Oh, when you're confident, it's never a good thing. God, it's Morris.
No. My confidence has been a great thing a lot of times on this show, but it is weird. Like, to sit here, we've had much better teams, like, record-wise, heading into the Big Ten tournament that I was terrified. I feel good about it. Like, it feels like the way that we're playing right now, and again, you know, you're one bad performance away from all the bad memories flooding back, but this does feel like a team that is peaking at the right time and ready to play its best basketball now.
And Michigan State, let's say you get past that first game, which is never a guarantee with Indiana, of course, in the Big Ten tournament, but you get Michigan State, Nick Ward will be back. They've kind of gotten into a rhythm without him. He's going to be back. You're kind of forcing him. Well, they think he's going to be back. You'll be forcing him sort of back into that rotation, which isn't a bad thing for them, but it's going to be interesting to see how a guy like Tillman reacts to having his minutes cut and, you know, coming off the bench instead of starting. But also, that's a team Indiana's beat twice. I know it's hard to beat a team three times. And
the stats actually don't back that up, by the way.
Oh, really?
No. Now, I mean, a lot of that, though, is probably like teams that are really good beating a team that isn't very good three times. I don't know what it is if you're the underdog both times, but also, overall, the stats don't back that up.
Don't the top seeds in the Big Ten tournament have like a really bad record over the last couple of years, too? I mean, or am I imagining? I thought somebody said that the other day, that number one seeds in that early game on Friday don't do particularly well, or at least they're good close games. And
Michigan came out of the 8-9 game and won it last year, didn't they?
Yeah.
Was that last year that happened?
I think so. But yeah, it's, you know, anything can happen in a tournament setting. And especially, again, this might be a good time for IU to catch somebody on an early game as opposed to being the ones that have to play the early game when you want to play a night game. I mean,
you say anything can happen. The one thing that hasn't happened in the Big Ten tournament is Indiana actually going and winning the damn thing. So let's just do it. Hey,
let's just do it. Why not? I mean, we're certainly due for a good showing in the Big Ten tournament. There's no other way to put that.
Yeah, take it one game at a time, but, you know, I feel good about it. So this brings up an interesting question. So Indiana plays the early game Thursday. So we obviously have the post-game show after that. The question is then, do we record Assembly Call Radio Thursday night?
No, we should.
Maybe
we should.
A special bracketology edition of Assembly Call Radio to break down the implications if Indiana wins on Thursday.
Well, do we want to do this after the show's over and discuss our schedule?
I'm just throwing it out there for something quick, not if it's going to require a long discussion.
Well, what I would say, my suggestion would be do our radio show after the game, and then we could do a special sort of quick bracketology thing from Andy afterwards. We don't need to do a whole hour-long episode of what Indiana's chances are in bracketology, I don't think. Do we?
Yeah, probably. I don't know. It's going to be complicated at that point.
Let's be honest. What am I going to contribute to that show?
Nothing.
Exactly. So I'll just skip out. You guys do it.
I'm liking the idea more and more. I don't know.
Bring Coach on and do like a quick half hour, like, you know, update.
We'll have content for you. We will have post-game content. We will probably have additional content because it's March, and that's what we do. We sacrifice sleep and time with our families to provide content. And hopefully we can do that for a long time.
You made that sound really sad. We sacrifice sleep and time with our families just for you.
That's what every college basketball writer and analyst does this time of year. I'm just being realistic about it. It just is what it is. Okay, let's wrap up. You're listening to the Assembly Call IU postgame show. Remember that because you're an Assembly Call listener, you get 15% off your entire order at HoosierProud.com and at HomeFieldApparel.com. So if you want officially licensed IU gear, go to HomeFieldApparel.com. And if you want one of our Assembly Call logo t-shirts or one of Hoosier Proud's unique Indiana-inspired designs, visit HoosierProud.com. And on both sites, use the promo code ASSEMBLY at check out for 15% off your entire order. All right, guys, it is time for last call. Final thoughts on this Indiana victory. Andy, you go first.
Well, again, I feel like we've gotten on here. I've said the same thing the last few games, but it's really impressive to see how this team has somehow picked itself up off the mat yet again. Archie mentioned that in his comments before senior day or before the speeches and things like that. So, you know, they did what they needed to do down the stretch, and hopefully that can continue with the newfound offensive firepower and Hopefully defense ratchets itself back up a little bit to where it was against Wisconsin and Michigan State as we head into the Big Ten tournament. And one of the things that becomes intriguing for a tournament setting that we've talked about a lot in this game is the depth that has finally manifested itself for this team after being a deficiency for a good part of the year based on all the injuries and things like that. I think if you're going to be able to make a run over the course of a tournament, and in IU's case would have to win 4 games in 4 days to do it, you don't do that with the short rotation. You need guys to be able to come in and step up and be able to rely on people. And that's the one thing that has been there for this team during this late season stretch. And certainly hope that is something that we'll see continue as the team heads to Chicago, but hopefully they can get a little bit of rest. And, you know, once again, thanks to the seniors, these guys have given a lot to the program for varying degrees of time and for in varying roles over the course of that. But I really, you know, a fun group of guys. It's, as you said, a hard part to, you know, bittersweet to watch some of these guys go. But it's hard to imagine a better performance on senior day than what Juwan Morgan showed in this game. And so many things that he showed on the court were just emblematic of the things that he showed over the course of his career at IU, and the lengthy list of achievements that they rattled off as he was standing there, where he kind of, it felt like he started to get embarrassed because he just kept going and going and going with what he had done, but just seems to be by all measures an outstanding young man, an outstanding basketball player, and looking forward to seeing what I hope is a lot more games of his before his career officially comes to an end.
Ryan, last call.
Yeah, I just think a great finish to this season for this Indiana team. They could have packed it up and gone home, and just, you know, the seniors could have checked out and the young guys could have just started looking forward to next season after that Minnesota game. They didn't. They you know, fought in two tough losses, and then they reeled off 4 in a row to really put themselves in a position to make this to make the tournament. And quite frankly, with all they've dealt with this year, it'd be a great tribute to them if they came back and were able to put themselves in the NCAA tournament. I think we all want that. I think we're all pushing hard for that. And there's no one we're pushing harder for it for than Juwan Morgan, who I think deserves to get back to the NCAA tournament. He's a guy who has exemplified what Indiana basketball is all about. Came from, and he wasn't an Indiana guy. He came from Missouri. You know, I mean, it's just proof that you can be a great Hoosier from anywhere. And he did. He is. And a guy who even in his speech said something about, you know, there were times where I wanted to transfer. I think every kid who comes to Indiana from somewhere else who's 18, 19, maybe even 20 gets homesick at some point and wants to check out and change things. And he relied on his friends on the team to push him to stay. And thank God they did, because he's a guy who is so much fun to watch. And I've been so impressed with him, not just as a basketball player, his development, but as a person as well. His parents did a fantastic job. And, you know, he thanked, you know, he and some of the other guys all thanked Tom Crean in their speeches. And I think I have to thank Tom Crean for picking Juwan Morgan too and bringing him in, because he's been a guy that has just been such a great addition to this program. And now to the program's history, is as we mentioned, he's in the top 10, you know, a bunch of top 10 lists, and he's one of the top 30 scorers and all that stuff. And that'll never go away. Those marks will always be there. And he's got a chance to add to them as they go to Chicago this week. This is a team that just looks like it is not done. It looks like a team that's just getting going. And so hopefully they can reverse some of that bad luck that we've seen from the Big Ten tournament in the past. And you know, I'll be watching. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to roll. And if there was ever a season for this team to make a run in the Big Ten tournament and have a good showing, it's this one, where everything seemingly has been flipped on its head. This team is playing like it did in November and December. And you know, the guys who got it, the run that got us so excited about this team. So let's hope they can go finish it out on Thursday and play a big one on Thursday, and then get us lined up on Friday with a great team and see what can happen.
Absolutely. By the way, I have breaking bracketology news here. Zach Osterman just tweeted this out. It's from Bart Torvik's website, where he basically, you know, takes a team's NCAA tournament resume and compares it to other teams, the most similar profiles. Of the 10 teams with the most similar resumes to Indiana, 9 of them were at-large teams. 3 of them were 9 seeds. You got a few 10 seeds, a few 11 seeds. And a few of those teams actually did some things. Arizona made a Sweet 16. Florida State made an Elite 8. A couple teams made the round of 32. So at least according to that tool at Bart Torvik's site, Indiana, as we know, trending in the right direction. But now when you look at similar resumes, the vast majority of those teams did make the tournament. So have to see. Indiana's going to have to keep winning. But that is at least another positive NCAA tournament note here as we end today. And you know, I echo what you guys both say. It's been a pleasure watching Juwan Morgan play basketball. It's been a pleasure, you know, covering him as we do on this postgame show, from, you know, guy who played sparingly early in his freshman year to you know, kind of joining OG Anunoby and really providing a shot in the arm for that 2016 team, especially on the defensive end, you know, where it was noticeable when those two guys were in the game in about the middle part of the season. It's like, wow, the defense gets a lot better when those two guys are playing. You know, and seeing him battle through the shoulder injuries and the other injuries that he suffered, and then, you know, what he's been able to do the last 2 years under Archie Miller, being the focal point of the offense, sometimes to the point where it felt like the other, you know, all five defensive players were just kind of selling out to stop him. And he, you know, all through it all was tough. You know, Warriors, a word that gets thrown around a lot with him, but to battle what he's had to battle, and now to, you know, help lead this team out of the depths of losing 12 of 13 to finish strong 4 in a row, to give themselves a chance, you know, heading in here to the Big Ten tournament, to make a run, to win some games, to possibly make the NCAA tournament and fulfill, you know, the promise that he made at the start of the season. It would be a fitting conclusion to Juwan Morgan's Indiana career to fulfill that promise, to lead this team to the NCAA tournament. You know, it's like, you know, with you know, guys like Yogi Ferrell and all these guys, you know, you want to make the tournament because you want to be in the tournament. But man, like, I just want to spend 40 more minutes with them as players, as a fan watching a player play, and then 40 minutes after that and 40 minutes after that. Juwan's given us so many great moments. It's been such a pleasure to watch him play. And I hope, even though we won't see him play, hopefully, at home anymore, I hope we still have many, many more games to watch and enjoy him play and to see him lead this team to victory here as we close out the rest of this season. All right, that'll do it for us on this edition of the Assembly Call IU Postgame Show. If you want to see us do the show live and be part of the live chat, make sure that you subscribe to our YouTube channel, youtube.com/assemblycall. You can also subscribe to our podcast by searching for Assembly Call wherever you listen to podcasts. And don't forget to go to assemblycall.com or text IU to 66866 to join our free email newsletter. Thank you for listening. We'll be back on Thursday to talk about Indiana's Big Ten tournament opener. Until then, keep your elbows in and your eyes on the rim. And go Hoosiers.
Thank everybody for coming out.
All right, I got to get out of here, folks. Thank you.
And obviously, we'll be back on Monday for Banner Monday, too. It's not like we're not going to have any content between now and then. We'll have Banner Monday. We'll have Banner Mornings. So we'll keep you updated on the bracketology stuff. We'll have an episode of Podcast on the Brink between now and then. Anytime you and Coach want to just hop on and do a live broadcast, you know, talking about bracketology, you can do it. People will watch if you have time for such
shenanigans. I think that might be true. Yeah. So I definitely,
you're out Thursday.
98% sure that I can't do it. I might try to at least earmark Friday afternoon to maybe take off if they get that far. But yeah, I can't really swing it since it was 12:30. I was bummed when I saw that was the time. Also, a really good drop that you need to get from Ryan at some point. He said something to the effect of, I didn't even put it in the chat so that we all wouldn't start laughing. Easy to enjoy watching guys enjoying themselves. So just...
What? Now it's also a drop of you since you've said it.
That is unfortunate.
You need to type those things out by email.
Well, I did type it, but then I couldn't put it in the chat because I figured both of you would lose it. I think it was at some point in the third segment. I'm not 100% sure, but okay.
I gotta go find that.
And I think because you were in the third segment, yeah.
Because you were so nice in alerting me to that, I will not use it against you that you said that out loud as well.
Excellent. Excellent. I appreciate that. You're a good man, Jerod Morris.
Now that one I probably will use.
Okay, that's
fine.
So anyway, all right. Sounds good. We'll talk this week for sure.
Good luck with your bracketing. Make sure you're all following Andy if you're not already for all the bracketology news that you need.
Yep, definitely we'll have one out Tuesday morning. If I may, depending on how the rest of the evening goes, may try to get one done to have up Monday morning.
And then is it daily updates after that?
So yeah, worst case Tuesday through Sunday with daily updates. Although the weekend should be interesting because my daughter has a soccer tournament. I'm not exactly sure how that's going to work, but we'll figure that out as we go.
Why isn't Daddy here? Now look, he is.
I won't miss the game. I'll figure something out.
No, I know you. I know.
Yeah. I'll definitely figure something out. I'm not sure what that's going to
be. No sleep.
I'm not sure what that's going to be quite yet. Yeah, it's one thing. It's really if they make the final on Sunday. I feel like it's going to be bumping up against the time when like final brackets would be done. So that might be challenging. The other stuff is fine. Like I can miss what's going on in games for a while and go to her games and catch up later. That's the one that might be difficult.
I know I've got my niece's birthday party Sunday from 4 to 6. So we have to see what happens there if we actually do make it to the to the final.
Who knows?
Anyway. All right, everybody.
Thanks, everybody.
Cool. We'll talk to y'all Monday for Banner Monday.
All right.
See y'all then.